Those of us in the Cambridge Brexit campaign are of the view that it's absolutely essential that the British left rejoins the old left heroes like Tony Benn and Bob Crowe and others in euroscepticism. For some reason, the left seems to have taken this walk into being europhiles, and we want to bring it back to where it belongs in euroscepticism, which is why we've invited Mr. Hopkins to come and speak this evening. The layout for tonight will be Mr. Hopkins will give his speech, and then we'll open up a simple Q&A session with the audience. Mr. Hopkins is the Labour MP for Luton North. He was an anti-austerity rebel under a Miliband and was one of the 36 people who nominated Jeremy Corbyn for his Labour leadership ballot. So please join me in welcoming Mr. Hopkins.
Well, thank you very much. I'm delighted to be here. Please do call me, refer to me as Kelvin. I'm perfectly happy to use my first name. Good to be back in Cambridge. You know, I've been here a few times. So I used to go to Robinson College quite a lot because there were a lot of good left Keynesian economists there. Probably they've all been wiped out now, but nevertheless, I used to go there quite a lot. I didn't study at Cambridge. I have to say, first of all, that Europe is a beautiful place. I go to Europe a lot. I go there for my holidays every year. I love European peoples, European countries, European culture, everything from J.S. Bach to Velasquez, from Maupassant to Shakespeare. Europe is a fabulous place, but the European Union is not Europe. It's a political construct imposed upon Europe, and it's one that I don't think works, certainly not in the interests of working people anyway. And my three-phrase view on Europe is that it's anti-democratic, anti-socialist, and failing economically. And if we go back to the early days, Labour, of course, was the Eurosceptic party, and the left has always been, under the surface, the real threat, I think, to the architects of the European Union. The right has had a nationalist side to it, but they've always been a bit ambivalent because they, at the same time, they're neoliberals and believe in a globalised neoliberal world where the corporates have power and democratic governments don't. But at the same time, they had this nationalist. And I think in my pamphlet I've written here, I talk about the Janus faces of Thatcher, because she couldn't quite make up her mind whether she was a pure neoliberal or a nationalist with neoliberal tendencies. And I think towards the end of her term in office, I think it became clear that she was turning to nationalism and uneasy about neoliberalism, which is why Geoffrey Howe, who was a true neoliberal, did his best to destroy her. But the left was against, and if you go back to the first tight days of the common market, in his last year of life, Clem Attlee said we shouldn't join. Hugh Gaitskill said we was against joining. Nye Bevan was against. And we had many others, Peter Shaw, Brian Gould, Dennis Skinner, my good friend Dennis, who's a wonderful man, of course. I find myself in the lobby more often with Dennis than anybody else. Even though culturally we don't sound alike or look alike, we're actually politically very close. And I think Dennis has got more common sense than any other 10 MPs, but there we are. And of course, Tony Benn. Tony Benn was a personal friend, came to speak for me in my campaign in Luton. And Bob Crowe, I knew Bob very well too, and spoke on platforms with him. Had Tony Benn and Bob Crowe lived, they would have been leading our campaign now. And I think it would have given a tremendous boost. But when they tried to denigrate Euroscepticism as being a right-wing tendency, and there may be people of the right in the room now, it's just untrue. Euroscepticism has support in various parts of the political spectrum, but I think the serious opposition to the European Union is actually comes from the left, because increasingly people see that it's anti-working class. I was in Brussels a couple of months ago, and there was a massive demonstration against TTIP, which I'll talk about later. And the whole of the centre of Brussels was cordoned off with police, who had guns and water cannon, and so on. It was a serious anti-TTIP demonstration by trade unions from all across Europe, but it was hardly reported. You know, just didn't figure because, you know, the political establishment doesn't want it to be known that the left is actually under the surface its real threat, and across the European Union, it is very very much against what the European Union is doing. I say I want Britain to come out of the European Union, not just because I want to be separate, but I want actually the European Union to be broken down into re-establish democratic, independent countries working together on a voluntary basis for mutual benefit, but not governed by a supranational bureaucracy in Brussels. And I think we would get on very well with each other if it was all broken down. Britain coming out would actually make a difference to many of the other countries, and I think other countries might think about it as well, particularly when it comes to the euro. So Labour historically has been the Eurosceptic party. And why did it change its position? Well, there was always a broadly speaking, right-wing group within the Labour Party who wanted to stay in the EU, or common market as was. They wanted to switch Labour's policy. And they saw their opportunity after the 1987 election, when Labour had lost three times to Thatcher, three times in a row. And as a council of despair, they said, oh, well, the only protection we're going to get from Thatcher will be to support being a member of the European Union. And of course, they had some social Europe, it was called. They had some protections, allegedly, for workers in the European Union. I shall come on to say I don't really believe that a little later on. But nevertheless, they took their opportunity. The trade unions in despair leapt into bed with the euro enthusiasts, and the Labour Party switched its position. But the left within the Labour Party carried on with its view. And Tony Benn in particular, who was, I think, the greatest intellectual challenger to the EU from the left, carried on his case. So it was, as I say, a council of despair that the party changed its view. But even then, shortly after that, within a couple of years, we were being persuaded that it was a good idea to join the exchange rate mechanism, which was a forerunner of the euro, the single currency, to peg Britain's currency, the sterling, to the Deutschmark as a prelude to fixing them all together into a single currency. I wrote a paper, I was an economist, I worked for NALGO, the trade union, which is now part of Unison, and I wrote a paper saying that it was a mistake and it would go wrong and this is what would happen. I said that initially interest rates would go down, but over time we wouldn't be able to sustain that parity to stop the currency, the link being broken. Interest rates would have to rise and rise and rise again. And they rose up to 13, 14, 15%. Tens of thousands of, hundreds of thousands of people lost their homes because they couldn't pay their mortgages. But we were persuaded by the political establishment. The TUC supported the ERM, the Labour Party supported the ERM, the Conservative Party supported the ERM, the Liberal Democrats, of course, everybody supported the ERM. But it was a small group of us saying it was nonsense. Indeed, Wynne Godley, who was a former Treasury official and great Cambridge economist, he put the case against the exchange rate mechanism. I had an interesting experience because I worked as an economist for the union in the research department, and I wrote my paper. I managed to persuade my union leaders that it was the ERM was a disaster. And the August before it all collapsed, there was a meeting of the TUC Economic Committee, and Rita Donaghy, who was president of the union, she was on the committee, and she said, went at the TUC, we think it's nonsense. The TUC thought it was a wonderful idea, so they decided to have a debate. And Rita came back to me and said, Kelvin, we're going to have a debate at the TUC on the ERM, for and against. Can you find us somebody who will put the case against the ERM? So I asked around, and we eventually got Wynne Godley to agree. Great man himself. So I telephoned through to Rita, and she said, well, tell the TUC. I said, well, look, I'm only a research officer. They won't take it from me. Tell them that I've told you to tell you who your name is. So I telephoned Bill Callahan, who is head of the economic department of the TUC, and he said, he was very grumpy when I told him that we got Wynne Godley, because it was like, one of the great economists of the time, to put our case. And he said, haven't you got a sound money man as well? I said, well, that's not my problem. That's your problem. You've got to find out. And he said, oh, I can't remember his name now. There was an economist whose wife worked for Gordon Brown, and he was worked for Goldman Sachs, and he was the economic correspondent of The Independent at the time. And Bill Callan said, what about, and I wish I could remember his name, I can't remember his name. What about him? And I said, well, didn't you read his column last week, Bill? He said, no. I said, well, he's changed his mind. He's on our side now. But that was an experience. And of course, before the debate could take place, the whole thing collapsed in what I call Golden Wednesday, and some people call Black Wednesday, in September 1992. Shortly after that, of course, that damaged the Conservative Party so badly. And it was that experience with hundreds of thousands of people losing their homes because of the rise in interest rates, that which led on to the victory of Labour in 1997. Actually, the economy was starting to recover. Why? Because when Britain came out of the exchange rate mechanism, they immediately devalued, which made our exports competitive again, and we started to recover. But the recovery was in full swing by the time Labour got into office. But the people were still so terrified of a Tory government, they voted Labour in any case. Tony Blair claimed all the credit, but I think it was much more to do with the fact that hundreds of thousands of people lost their homes and they never didn't want the Tories back. But the exchange rate mechanism brought Labour in 1997. My case, I think there's a pretty strong case as well. But shortly after that, of course, there was pressure to join the euro. And Treasury got it right for once because they were terrified that, you know, the same sort of thing would happen as happened with the ERM. And so they persuaded Gordon Brown, and Gordon Brown went along with the officials not to join the euro, much to Tony Blair's annoyance because he wanted to go gung-ho for joining the single currency. But we managed to stay out with a sort of device. You know, we had five tests, and if we didn't pass the five tests, we wouldn't go in. Well, it was basically we were not going to go in, and it looks like, you know, most parties are now saying we will never join. I don't trust them, of course, because if they got an opportunity, they would take us in even now, despite it. But it's interesting, Larry Elliott from The Guardian, some of you may read Larry Elliott, he's economist, economic correspondent, and he wrote a piece about a year ago saying, had Britain joined the euro at the kind of parity at that time, roughly €1.50 to the pound, it would have destroyed our economy. We could not have competed at that level. And what would have happened, we would have been like Greece but writ large. We would have seen mass unemployment, collapsing industries and so on. We would have crashed out of the euro. And I think people would have demanded that we had to reintroduce sterling. And then, of course, the whole euro edifice would have collapsed. But we didn't go in. And the first country to really get into trouble was Greece, and they can't, the Greeks, the reason the Greeks stay in is nothing to do with their economy, it's to do with the fact that they are terrified of where they are in the world. They were part of the Ottoman Empire, they've got Turkey next door, massive country. They want to hang on to anything that says Europe, and if they get out of the euro and recreate the drachma, they will see themselves becoming slightly arm's length from the core of the European Union. And I've spoken to left-wingers who understand the problem of the euro, but they still won't leave it because it means loosening links with Europe, as they see it, or the European Union. And they are surrounded, they're not far from, well, you've seen the refugee crisis. They're just next door to Turkey, making them very, very uneasy. They're not far away from Syria and Israel and all the countries, the Islamic countries of North Africa, which are unstable. So you can understand that they want to hang on to their Europeanism, if you like. And for that reason, they've decided, at least for the time being, to stay inside the euro. I think the Greeks' problems are not over yet. When you think that they've been forced to privatise public assets and sell them off at cheap rates, they've been told that they've got to put a brake on collective bargaining so workers can't collectively bargain for their wages and incomes. We've got 25% unemployment. We've seen living standards and the output fall by 25%. 50% young people unemployed. If we had the same situation in Britain, we wouldn't just have 1.7 million unemployed in Britain. We would have 7 million people or 7.5 million people unemployed. If we had 7.5 million people unemployed, I think there'd be quite a big political reaction. But even without that, you know, things have not gone as well as they should do. But the Greeks have a terrible problem, and they're in this great dilemma, being pulled both ways. But I don't think the Greek tragedy is quite over yet. You know, I think what we ought to say to them is, if you come out of the euro and recreate the drachma, we will speak in solidarity with you because we have our own currency as well. It's interesting that a couple of weeks ago, David Cameron said the obvious, that the European Union is a multi-currency union. And the European, those who run the European Union, study spitting feathers. it's not a multi-currency union, it's a euro union. Just that a lot of currencies aren't in yet. But, you know, I know, for example, the Poles are in no hurry to join. The Czechs have basically said they're never going to join. We have said we're never going to join. The Danes have got a separate currency and proposed never to join. In Sweden, the last opinion poll suggested that 11% of the population would be prepared to join the euro. There's clearly not going to be other countries, many other countries joining the euro. Only those countries who are desperate to hang on to that European tag in the way the Greeks are, that would persuade them to join. But anyway, we didn't join the euro. The euro is still there. Had we joined, it would have, I think, would have destroyed the whole edifice. But we go back to 1944. Don't know how many of you are economists, but remember 1944, the Bretton Woods Conference, where the great John Maynard Keynes, Cambridge economist, designed the post-war world. And he got it right. He didn't get all his own way because the Americans resisted some things. But he said that we should have pegged currencies with the possibility of devaluation when currencies needed to. They could arrange, you know, negotiate with other countries, but they would be able to devalue. We devalued in 1949, 1965, and then, of course, we had floating currencies later on, and we did devalue or depreciate a lot later on as well. But Keynes also said, not that countries who had big balance of trade deficits should be permitted to devalue, but he said that countries with big trade surpluses should be required to revalue their currencies. Well, which country has a gigantic trade surplus and has an undervalued currency? The Germans in the euro. And I actually call the euro the Deutschmark, because it is, that's what it is really. It's the Deutschmark with a few other currencies attached, bolted onto it. If those other countries decided to recreate their own currencies, other countries, so recreate their own currencies, the Deutschmark would surface and it would rocket upwards and come to an appropriate parity with other countries. At the moment, it's being held down by these weaker currencies, which gives the German economy an unfair competitive advantage against countries like ourselves. And just to show you what would happen, I think, if the euro was dissolved, the Swiss pegged their currency until a couple of years ago to the euro. And one day they decided to break the link and let it float. What happened? Over a weekend, the Swiss currency appreciated by 30%, which is a staggering thing to happen. And I think the same would happen to Germany. But countries which cheat by having low parities for their currency to build gigantic trade surpluses are actually, in the end, vulnerable. And countries which live with big trade surpluses, in the end, will lose because other countries will rise. Japan did the same after the Second World War. They were permitted to do so. I mean, clearly the West wanted Japan and Germany to stay in the Western capitalist fold and not be tempted by going to the East or to communism. So they were allowed to run their economies in a very way which was beneficial to them. And they big trade surpluses. Japanese had a massive trade surplus, and they can't sustain it. When they get to a certain level and the currency appreciates to an appropriate level, they can't sustain it. So allowing countries to sustain falsely low parities, I think, is in the end a mistake. Keynes understood that. He wanted them to be required to revalue so that currencies would be appropriate to every country's internal economic performance. Anyway, anti-democratic. Well, it's quite clear that the European Union wants power to shift from parliaments, national parliaments, to the European Commission. Effectively, I mean, they call it the European Union, but it's actually the Commission that has the real power. And they want to marketize. I mean, just one example, they've thing called the Fourth Railway Package, which is forcing the European railways to do what we've done in Britain, which is a disaster, I think, you know, to fragment and try to get competition going between railway operators, even if the infrastructure stays in public hands. The Fourth Railway Package. So they're going to make as big a mess of continental railways as we've made of our railways by forcing through the Fourth Railway Package. But it's a market mechanism. Instead of having nationalised railways, which are integrated and run in public interest, and actually, of course, work very well, Just not so long ago, there was a report by Sir Roy McNulty. Some of you may have heard the McNulty report. And he, his first discovery was that continental railways, the nationalised ones, were up to 40% cheaper to run than Britain's railways. And I put it to him, well, wasn't it obvious what the problem was? You know, that we have our railways in, well, the operators in private ownership, and they're making money out of the taxpayer and the fare payer. And the evidence for that, of course, was East Coast Main Line. When East Coast Main Line for 5 years was in public ownership, it made a surplus of £1 billion, which went into the Treasury. Now it's been forced back into privatisation, because the one thing Tory governments, and indeed all neoliberal governments, even New Labour ones, they're worried about is actually when the public sector works very well, it makes it very embarrassing when you've privatised something that doesn't work so well. So, you know, it's quite clear that the left makes the European Union and all the neoliberals nervous. But shifting power away from democratic governments into the market, and thus into the hands of the corporate world, I think is what the EU is about. And if you want any conclusive proof about that, look at the support for TTIP, which is the Transatlantic Trade and Investment Partnership. And what that is about is, again, shifting power into the hands of the corporate world. Whatever they say, they keep on saying they're going to have qualifications and it won't be as bad as they say it's going to be. But reality is they want to privatise public services to make money, and they want governments to have no power to bring them back into public ownership. And if they do, they want to be able to prosecute governments for the loss of profits, not just current profits, the loss of anticipated profits as well. So it's really, once they've gone into private ownership, they'll never be able to get back into public ownership, unless there's some kind of real radical revolutionary change, of course. But that's what it's really about. And the EU is negotiating that in secret. So it's quite clear what they're about. Another component of its anti-democratic behaviour, of course, is the end of unanimity. Things used to be voted through when every country in the European Union voted yes. And if one country said no, it didn't happen. Then that now they've invented quantitative majority voting, qualitative majority voting, QMV, which means that you have a weight attached to your currency, and if you know majority votes can be, everything is done by, can be done by majority vote now, effectively, with bigger countries having obviously more votes than smaller countries. But it means that it's the end of unanimity, so you can't stop things. Laws being made by the European Union are now subject to judgments by the European Court of Justice. We can't make a judgment about that. And if, in fact, of course, there's one famous case recorded by Tony Benn, where we were, it was a maritime law, where we were taken to the European Court of Justice and found to be in breach. And so we had to back off as a government. It was a first major challenge to democratic power in Parliament. I've said just recently that, those of you who study politics remember a man called Walter Badgett wrote the English Constitution. He talked about, you know, the effective and the decorative part of the Constitution. The effective part has power, and in his day it was the cabinet, which was fairly secretive, and the decorative. Well, my fear is that parliaments will become decorative. They will be elected, but they won't actually have any power, because all the power will be held by the European Union. So that's the anti-democratic part, and I think that's fairly conclusive. And many people don't worry about that, because some of the countries in the European Union have come from fascism, they've come from the communist East, and they're not too bothered about whether or not the European Union is democratic or not. They just want to be in it because they don't like the past. Well, some of us weren't. We've not had dictatorship, and we are. We think democracy is very precious and something that's very important. We want to be able to elect governments, elect parliaments, and governments that enact laws that govern us. And if we don't like the laws, we can change the government and change the laws. You can't do that inside the European Union, in effect. The anti-socialist bit of privatisation and the fire sales of public assets in the debtor countries. And we've seen, of course, some of those countries which are apparently overcoming their problems, and one such is Ireland. Ireland has been trumpeted as being a great success, but actually what Ireland did they exported 300,000 of their people to find work elsewhere. Now, if you scale that up to the size of the United Kingdom, that's 4.5 million. Imagine if we had Greeks unemployment, 7.5 million, and Irish emigration at 4.5 million. We'd have 4.5 million people leaving the country and 7.5 million people unemployed. What do you think the reaction would be in Britain if we had that? So that's what people that other countries have suffered. And some of them are so concerned to stay in the European Union, and their political class has decided that they want to stay in, that they won't challenge anything. So we have, I think, just a case against the European Union is not difficult to make. But people talk about other things like, well, there's been no wars. Well, is that a non sequitur? I mean, there's been no wars between members of the European Union. But would we have had a war without the European Union? I don't think so. Why would we have done? We've just had the Second World War. We're getting on in a more democratic way of doing things. And in fact, I would argue, and I do argue, that the European Union is actually creating tensions between countries which would not have been there had we not had the European Union. You've seen anti-German sentiment rising in Greece. You've been in Portugal and Spain, people talking about German dominance. We're not going to tolerate being told what to do by the Germans. These tensions would not have been there had we not had the European Union and indeed the Euro. So I think the tensions are greater with the European Union than they would have been without it. But I cannot see that the European Union has stopped wars taking place. The big conflict after the Second World War was between the Communist East and the Capitalist West, and we had NATO, and eventually the communist world imploded, and it all came to an end, and many countries now are much more democratic, and even the least democratic of them are rather more democratic than they were. Fascism, again, it wasn't the European Union that actually invaded and brought down fascism. It was their own countries. They decided they didn't want it anymore, and the fascists lost out. But you could argue that case, that there's, if you wish to, that the European Union has actually stopped wars taking place. I don't think it's true. I think that would have happened anyway. And had we had six more successful economies and hadn't had the mass unemployment and the economic disruption and the pain of what's happened over the austerity of the European Union, I think people would have been less likely to fight each other rather than more likely. So I'm really coming to an end, but I must say I'm looking forward to leaving the EU, because I think life outside would be much better. I think we'll be in a good position to go and argue the case with fellow people who feel like the same as we do on the continent of Europe. And look at the benefits for us. I mean, for a start, I mean, we're paying net into the budget something like £18 billion a year. Some people say it's £14 billion, £18 billion. But it's a lot of money. If we just had a quarter of that to spend on the health service problems overnight disappear. Because, an extra £4 or 5 billion on the health service, and that's what we should do. In fact, we do spend far too little on the health service, and even compared with some of the countries in the European Union. But we could spend more on that. I think personally, if we started collecting taxes from the rich and from the corporates, like Google, but much more, and the tax gap has been calculated at $120 billion by Richard Murphy. If we got a quarter of that, $30 billion extra, well, that would be wonderful. I personally believe, actually, we should have higher tax rates on the rich. And I don't mean just the rich, I mean people like me. Members of Parliament, £74,000 a year. Do you think I could pay a bit more tax? I think I could, actually. And I actually say this on the radio and on the doorstep, that I think I should pay a bit more tax. But not people on lower incomes, of course, but they should pay possibly less on tax. And the idea that, if you increase tax rates, people just evade and avoid more. Well, I think, sending one or two tax avoiders to prison for tax evaders to prison for concentrates and minds. But there we are. Maybe I'm a bit too brutal about these poor, hard done by wealthy people. Manufacturing. Our manufacturing sector is too small. That's why we have a trade deficit. It should be rebuilt. And to do that, we should be able to use the state to intervene, to use state aid. We can't do that inside the European Union. So we can actually start to boost manufacturing. public procurement programmes. We're not allowed to use those without going out to compulsory competitive tender. I think we should actually be able to use public procurement to focus on British industry, to rebuild British industry, at least for until it's got back on its feet again. We could start reducing that gigantic trade deficit. At the moment, we import four times more cars from Germany than we export to Germany. Half our trade deficit is with Germany. It's the equivalent of exporting at least 500,000 jobs to Germany. Is Germany going to start causing problems for us on trade? If they really had a trade blockade with us, they'd be the losers, not us. So I just think the idea of a trade war is just nonsense. And motor manufacturers have said, well, we're going to stay in Britain anyway. Trade union rights. Jeremy Corbyn has said, you know, he's going to restore trade union rights. So I think it would be an immensely popular policy. There are so many people I meet in my surgery who want to join trade unions, who can't because of the laws which have weakened trade unions, and of course the relatively high unemployment we've had for some time. So if we start to rebuild manufacturing, rebuild full employment, run the economy on a post-war Keynesian lines, I think we could we would be immensely popular. I do believe that Labour can and will win the next election. At the moment, we're in a very, very bad place. Jeremy he's been savagely attacked by the political establishment, by many within the party, but 4.5 years more of this government and possibly another crisis coming as well. I think we could see Labour winning, and I like to think that Jeremy will be Prime Minister. And when that happens, we want to see, well, Jeremy has already promised he's going to restore trade union and worker rights. So I think that we'll generally have support for workers, social Britain, if not social Europe. So there are lots of things that are going to be good about coming out. We won't be subject to the common agricultural policy. We can choose to subsidise what agriculture we choose to do. We can buy what we need to buy, not have to worry too much about rules decided outside our shores. A major advantage will be able to reclaim our fisheries. Get at the common fisheries policy, reclaim the 200-mile or 50% limit, start to rebuild our fish stocks, rebuild our fishing industry, do what Norway does, monitor every boat, every fishing, every catch, and control its own fishing waters, and get the same level of stocks that the Norwegians have. There's no reason, we've got the biggest fishing grounds in the European Union, and I think we could really do very, very well outside the common fisheries policy. I've argued that as should be a priority. So there's so many things we could do outside the European Union, but I want to finish on the point that it's not just about Britain, it's about working people on the continent of Europe as well. And I've spoken on platforms with socialists, people of the left from France, from Italy, from Slovenia, from Sweden. I'm going to see some Danes very shortly. And a French socialist who was, when he spoke on our platform at our conference, the Eurosceptic platform, he was taken to task and I think punished by his party when he got back because he was a rare Eurosceptic in the French Socialist Party. And you know, there are millions of socialists across and trade unions across the continent of Europe who agree with our view. I want to work in solidarity with them as well so that we can start to rebuild a world of full employment, of social justice and equality, and economies that work and produce the kind of world which we had after the Second World War. Sometimes I say to you, you're highly well-informed young people, but there are people who don't appreciate what life was like when I was young. I mean, we had, first of all, full employment. You know, when you were in the summer after I'd finished my term at university, I would go and the first factory you came to, a list of jobs, you just go and get a job. And if you didn't like that job, went to the next factory, get another job, and work through the summer and earn plenty of money. But on top of that, you had full grants. My wife, I had, because of my parents' income, I was means-tested down, but my wife had a full grant when she went to teacher training college. It was a full grant on which she could live through the year. She had no fees, she had lived in Hall of Residence, and she had no fees, and she lived through the year comfortably. She did a bit of work in the summer so she could pay for a holiday as well on top of that. Imagine a world like that where there's no fees and everybody has a grant certainly those who don't have parents with high incomes, has a full grant on which you can live through the year. It's a world that's just, we've lost, a world that's been taken away. I have to say that 33 of us voted against when Blair decided out of the blue to abolish grants and introduce fees in 1998. 33 of us voted against, one of the first rebellions we had. And since then, I voted against on every occasion when fees have risen. But of course, it might mean we have to raise taxes to pay for it all. I think with full employment, of course, you have the advantage of the fact that very few people are claiming benefits because they're not unemployed, and people are working, so they're paying taxes, especially if we rein in the tax avoiders and evaders. So we could actually possibly do it all without actually raising taxes, but if we have to raise taxes, let's do it. Even in Denmark now, Denmark is one of those Scandinavian countries that's held on to some of its social democratic traditions and measures. One of the things they do, they have their higher rate of tax is not 40% as it hits, 60%, but then all students have a full grant until the age of 25 with no fees. So it can be done. It's not problematic, but we've got to be able to run our own economy in our own way, and get rid of this Tory government, of course, as well, and start to build a democratic socialist world once again. I'm probably best now if I try and answer some of your questions. I have a very strong view that we should leave the European Union, and I look forward not just to that, but to creating a socialist world afterwards, and not just a socialist world in Britain, but a socialist world in other European countries as well. So thanks for listening. I brought some copies of my pamphlet along, by the way. As I say, we've 9,000 copies of that have been printed, and we're printing a lot more now. But that's the last few we've got for this printing, unfortunately, so I bought them tonight. Did you want to do point two? Okay, yeah.
Hi, Pamphlet. I just want to make a quick point on for employment. I know what you said, but I would say that full employment was it was the way it was worked out. It was much different when you were growing up to how it is today. So I would perhaps caution against the possibility that it could happen again. Secondly, your speech was very interesting because it was very similar in makeup to the speeches for staying in the EU. 95% of it was a negative. Why we should leave? Look at what the other side is doing. And only 5% was about setting out an alternative in terms of economic strategy and importance. I'd just like you to talk briefly. Because I'm very, very worried about visas and access to the continent if we were coming out of Europe. I just want you to talk, about what in terms of the free movement of people, what the left perspective is. Thank you.
Well, I was about the EU rather than Europe, I have to say, and coming out, leaving the European Union, we will still be part of European geography, but I must find it strange. I've not heard anybody argue that the European Union is creating full employment and growth. They do have a growth and stability pact, but it's not much growth and very little stability, it seems to me. Full employment, you're absolutely right. I mean, one thing that was different when I was young is that many women stayed at home and didn't work. So women in the workforce now, but still. There is unemployment. Just recently, I went to visit a factory in the northern part of my constituency, and it's right next to a big estate where there are black and Asian people, a lot of black and Asian people, young people, unemployed. It's quite a high level of unemployment in that estate. Next door, we have this factory. People doing basic factory work, but all of them are young white women. And I was very surprised that there were no black and Asian women or boys or men and whatever. And I said to the foreman, they don't seem to reflect my constituents. He said, well, they're all from Lithuania, he said. And that's because if anybody from Lithuania comes to Britain to work, I completely understand why they want to do it. Wages are much higher here. They can live cheaply and send money back to their families. Who wouldn't want to come to Britain? I mean, I completely understand. But there's not, the European Union free movement is not about being benign to Lithuanians. It's about undermining wages and weakening wages. And if you, even today, there's put in the Guardian about low wages. Low wages enable employers not to invest. We have a very, very low level of productivity, no productivity growth at all, very low level of investment because we can get cheap labour. And if we want to, A, make sure all the people who live in this country actually have jobs, and we also have a higher level of investment and higher productivity, we've got to raise wages because that's a driver for people to invest. But anyway, this idea that our opponents are making the case, I think they try and frighten us, making us feel we're going to be bereft and left on our own and weak and our economy is going to be damaged. I don't think any of that is true. I think economically we'll be better off. But we even now, I'm not going to give the Tories too much credit, but we have much lower level of unemployment and our economy is less weak than the continentals. I mean, I won't say it's strong because it isn't strong, and I think it's a fairly hollowed out economy, and I think the whole of the developed world has a problem at the moment with economics, of which we're part of. So the neoliberal world is not working well for anybody, but we're not so badly off as some of those in the continent of Europe. I could develop that and go on, but I think I've probably said enough in what I was saying in my speech. But I don't think our opponents are saying the same thing as us. I think we're talking about employment, public ownership, managing economies in a way that through democratically elected governments, which is, I think, very different from what they're saying. So yes. Well, I have a very strong sense of being European. You know, I have a very strong European identity. I mean, all the things I like in life are all European. I'm not being sort of racist about the rest of the world, but, you know, my tastes are all to do with the European Union. With European culture. With Europe in the genuine sense. So I understand that identity, and I try to speak European languages a bit, you know, get by in French and a few words smattering of other languages. And I spend a lot of time going to these countries and feel completely at home with my, you know, European friends and colleagues and comrades. So I don't think we'll lose that identity. I don't think everybody feels the way I do, I have to say. You know, some people don't feel like that at all. They feel, a sense of loss of identity for other reasons. But I'm happy in my skin being English, British, and European, a citizen of the world, really. But so I don't think identity is a problem for me, and I don't feel I need to support the European Union to identify myself as a European.
For it's a matter of identity politics, supporting the European Union. What do we say to those people?
Well, I say it is actually failing economically, and we can have an identity, a European identity, with a different economic rate. It's a political construct, the European Union, and we could have a different construct. We could have a European Democratic Forum, if you like, which I agree with you. We've got to break that link between identity and the European Union. My tastes, the things I like most in life, are all to do with Europe. And particularly, I love music, classical music. The world without J.S. Bach will be a much less colourful world for me. A world without Burgundy and Bordeaux wine, without the paintings of Velasquez and Vermeer and Rembrandt would be, and the literature Balzac and whatever, you know, all of those things are all so important to me. And I feel complete, and when I try to speak French, not very well, but I try to speak French, and I feel completely at home in Europe. But there are lots of people on the continent of Europe, I think, feel the same as well, that they don't feel it necessary to be in the European Union to feel a strong sense of, but it's a very strong left, a left view. I think also there are different identities. I'm a humanist myself, but some people feel very strongly Catholic, for example, and their identity is dominated by their Catholicism, I'm in a sense more European than that, in the sense that I don't have that worldview. It is a problem. Climate change, I better touch on climate change. I mean, lots of things the European Union does, we've either taken a lead or could equally do ourselves. There's no reason we couldn't just agree with all our European colleagues on climate change. It's not just Europe, it's the rest of the world too. I'm co-chair with Caroline Lucas of the all-party group on fuel poverty and energy efficiency, and I'm passionate about climate change from the start, and I think some of the people on the right who are, climate change deniers are quite frankly bonkers, and very dangerous people as well, because they're stopping us building wind farms on land, mainly because they're Tories and they're in Tory areas. But, I every time I see a wind farm, I think, thank goodness for that, we're doing something sensible. I'd like to see more wind farms everywhere. I'm quite happy with nice big windmills going around generating electricity. I think it's a brilliant idea. Of course, we need more than that, but I don't see a problem about supporting climate change, but not being in the European Union, and working with colleagues who are in the European Union, or other colleagues in Europe, in support of climate change policies across the world. I can't see a problem. Yes, sorry.
So my question is kind of a spin on the last two questions. It's kind of linked to the nature of democracy and referendums in general. But how do you feel about the possibility of, if the out campaign is successful, that almost certainly that would be partly because of the very strongly nationalistic / perhaps xenophobic votes favouring an out vote, and maybe a lot of people not accepting the socialist argument but voting nationalists?
Well, obviously, it's one would feel uncomfortable, but on the other hand, I want to be out, and I do. I think there's a lot of working class people who are alleged to be xenophobes and nationalistic, but I think it's not just because they're not because they dislike foreigners. They feel genuinely insecure about the future because of work, and their children and their grandchildren getting jobs. And when bright, educated people come from Estonia and seem to get a lot of jobs, they feel uncomfortable about that. And middle-class people can always get jobs. They'll always survive. And, people who go to Cambridge or even Nottingham, as I did, we'll always be okay. But a lot of working-class people won't feel that. They will feel more insecure because of large numbers of people coming from overseas. It's interesting, in Luton, we've got nearly only about half our population can come from the old Commonwealth, black, Asian, Pakistani. Pakistani, Kashmir, the largest group, Bangladeshi, Indians, every country in Africa. And I think probably half my young people are non-white. But many of them are now saying, we're uneasy about the European Union, because they're going to be the first people in line when it comes to not getting jobs. And I've come across one, I was canvassing in the European elections, actually, the European Parliament elections, not last time, the time before. And there were three young Pakistani men outside a council house in my constituency. And I said, do you canvassing vote Labour? Because they were only vote Labour. No, they said, we're voting BNP. I said, what? You're voting BNP? British National Party. I said, well, what? They're a fascist party. What are you voting? Well, he said, they're against immigration. I said, well, but you know, but you're immigrants yourself. Yes, we are, but we don't want any more to come. And it was interesting how, you know, it was quite shocking, I found that. But there are people who do feel insecure, and they're people at the bottom of the economic pyramid, if you like, who feel most insecure and most threatened by large immigration. And of course, it's on the other side of this, you've got, there's a recent report, I've got a letter from a woman who was, she was the Estonian foreign minister, and she negotiated Estonia's entrance to the EU. And she's completely changed her mind. She said, because all the brightest and best young Estonians are now working in Western Europe. She said, we've left behind the old and the poor. And, you know, our country's being undermined because the people who should be our future have now gone. I understood that as well, many of them. And you find, of course, a high proportion of the people who work, we've got a lot of Poles and Lithuanians in Luton in particular. They are bright and they are young. Quite a few of them are actually graduates and they speak good English. Not all, but quite a few speak good English. So they are the brightest and best from their own countries. I think I've heard that even Lithuania now taking in workers from Belarus and places like that to fill the gaps just left by their own young people leaving. Well, you know, the whole country is going to be dissolved in a sense after a time. There won't be any Lithuanians or Estonians left. And I think that would be a great shame. I mean, we don't want to go on too much about identity, but I like the preserving languages and cultural, historic cultures and so on. I mean, I'm very strongly in favour of Welsh being promoted as a language and Irish and Scottish Gaelic. I mean, I think Scottish Gaelic's almost gone, but keep them going. They're all some of the great creations of humankind, languages. Why can't we keep those languages and the literature of those languages going and the music of those cultures? If they disappear, I think we lose something. And I'd like to think that Estonia and other countries can say, well, you know, we're proud of our country. We've got great young people coming along and we're going to make great contributions to the world. But if all those young people have gone, I think it would be a terrible shame.
But anyway. I guess by staying in the EU, you're not necessarily getting rid of one's own national identity. When you talk about European identity on the whole, but isn't that in a sense quite reductive? Because you completely ignore the fact that every country has their own national identity, and within the framework of the European Union, one can still have that national identity.
Indeed. And for the big countries, they will continue. But some small countries, then if so many people leave, and particularly the youngest, young, brightest and best, young, most able, should we say, not best, the brightest and most able young people leave, you know, they are weakened as a culture. A country as large as Britain wouldn't quite have that problem. But it is interesting, once people move abroad, and I found this in Luton, my agent in 1997, Hitesh Taylor, he came from an Indian Gujarati background, his family came from Kenya, you know, many did. And I said, do you still be Gujarati? He said, I can understand my mum, but I can't speak it. And even in a generation, you know, it's going, no, he's happy to be British, you know. Mm-hmm. But, and there are 50 million Gujaratis in India, so they're not going to lose Gujarati or lose India. But if all of the young people of Gujarat left, and left just a small number of elderly people fading away and dying out bit by bit, so I think that would be a great shame. And countries want to, you know, hold on to their literature, their culture, their young people, I mean, the Irish, I think, have had over generations. Almost everybody in Britain has some Irish ancestry. I've got Irish, part Irish descendants. My daughter-in-law is of Irish extraction, and so my granddaughters are, I think, quarter Irish or half Irish. But there's, you know, the sad music and literature of Ireland is all about loss of people being forced to go overseas because of the famine, because of poverty, and so on. And they've still got a population there. But at one time, Ireland had a population as big as England, if you go back some 100 years.
Would you be quite careful when you say that, because all the young generation of example that you're using are moving to Britain, that there's a loss of cultural identity in Estonia? Because that would still be kind of proliferated.
Yeah. It's not completely lost, but you know.
No, you're sort of painting this very bleak picture.
I just use an example, because this particular case of the former foreign minister who had changed her view. And I don't want to say we're going to stay static, and I like the fact that we go and work and live in each other's countries from time to time, and I think it's a great idea. And there will always be people moving across the countries, which I think. You know, we've benefited enormously from immigration. In fact, I was at our local hospital today, and they've just been to the Philippines, to India, and where else, recruiting nurses. And one of the problems, they can't get the nurses in. They've got 90 nurses from the Philippines. They can't get in because they can't get visas for them, because they're not in the European Union. But so the Philippines is a big place. But yeah, I don't want to stop movements entirely. But if one country has a very large proportion of its youngest stripped out, I think that's not a happy experience for them, and not a good thing for the world, personally. Yes.
Hi, Kelvin. Big fan of your work. I live in Buckinghamshire, which isn't too far away from Luton, good job over there. And I just want to say, big fan of what you're doing with, Labour League, which is very important. And also, there is a Cambridge Labour League page, so if any of you guys want to get involved in that, like the page, or, you can come speak to me and I'll let you know how you can get involved. But my question is, Jeremy Corbyn, you must know, because obviously you voted for him, I imagine he's a great guy in person, and he voted against the ECC in 1975, and he voted against Maastricht, and obviously now, he's obviously had to take some kind of deal with the more, Blairite figures like perhaps Hillary Benn or Maria Eagle, who obviously, they're ardently Europe. And obviously, I imagine they would have been in total revolt if there had been even a hint of, maybe they should kind of let's have some kind of debate about this, and they probably would have just, you see how, work that they can get about Trident and all these other issues. So I'm just wondering, because obviously these kind of things aren't decided by members on the ground, they're decided in boardrooms, they're decided by people at, committees and things like that. So I was wondering, how can we try and get proper debate in the Labour Party involving members about this? Because obviously, I'm sure Jeremy would love to have a debate about this, but it seems like there's kind of, a cabal, perhaps, the right wing kind of cabal of trying to do this, just slightly debating this.
I mean, Jeremy was a very close personal friend, and he used to come out and help me in my election campaigns. And cheers him, bye bye. Cheers. And Jeremy's a wonderful man, and I think was the first to nominate him, and I certainly voted for him as well. And I do understand his position, but as you say, he was a eurosceptic before, doesn't appear to be now. I don't think he's pushing the euro enthusiast boat out very far. He's not pushing it hard, he just has to go along. But I haven't had a conversation with Jeremy about it since his election. I've said this publicly because I've been asked so many times, but I've been asked several times to go on the front bench, various jobs by John McDonnell in particular. And I've not gone on the front bench for one reason only, to fight this campaign. Because on the front bench, I would not be able to do this. I'd be tied in my collective responsibility and couldn't speak. And I told John this. I thought, it wasn't a hard decision because there was nothing that was going to stop me saying what I think about the European Union. To have to go and tell lies would just be unacceptable. So but John said after the referendum's over, he'll come talk to me again. But absolutely happy with my decision. But what we are doing, the small band of us, we're going every invitation. We're accepting every invitation we can. I've just done Newsnight at the Cambridge Television Studios. Two interviews with your young people here. You tonight, I'm speaking at Central Bedfordshire, Mid-Beds Labour Party on Wednesday. I spoke at another Labour Party meeting last Friday. The weekend before that, I was in Cardiff. Weekend before that, I was in Glasgow, speaking in the same platform. And making sure people are aware, because many young people not aware that Labour was the Eurosceptic party. We were the left was took a socialist anti-common market position. And it wasn't just people on the left like me, it was mainstream people, people of the right. Hugh Gaitskill was against it, and Nye Bevan, as I mentioned, and so many others. And my views used to be mainstream in the Labour Party. Now they seem to be extreme or radical. But I know that there are millions of Labour voters, potential Labour voters, who support me, not just on xenophobic grounds, but on socialist grounds as well. They've seen what's happened to British industry. So, I think, and it's very important to go around talking about these economic issues, not about immigration, not pandering to a sort of xenophobia and nationalism or whatever, but actually talking about economics and saying it's about socialists and working class people on the continent of Europe as well. It's not just about us. So that's what I'm doing. I'm going around and doing what I can, speaking on platforms all the time, and whenever I'm asked to speak anywhere, I'm going to do it, and radio programs as well. So I'm trying to be fair. Yes.
Two articles on Jeremy Corbyn's manifesto. One was the people's quantities, nationalise the railways.
Yeah.
Would he face any difficulties with those in
the Lisbon Treaty? Well, I think we published a pamphlet called Jez You Can't, you know, Jez is his nickname, and saying the things that Jeremy wants to do and what the European Union wouldn't let him do. And it's possible renationalise the railways because of the fourth railway package and so on. I don't know about people's quantitative easing, but using, instead of just giving it to banks or giving it to paying off loans, whatever, actually using, you know, created money to spend on the health service and whatever. I don't know whether that would be allowed or not, but there are all sorts of things we would like to do. I've asked specifically about the common fisheries policy, and I've suggested in Parliament that we ought to, because it's such a disaster, particularly for the fish and the fishermen around our coasts, I've said, well, if we gave notice that we wanted to withdraw from the common fisheries policy and re-establish our traditional fishing limits, what would happen? And a British official from the European Commission said, you'd be expelled from the European Union. You cannot do it. And he was very angry with me, just read suggesting it. So there's all sorts of things which might not be possible, but we'll have to see. I suspect Jeremy would actually privately quite like that if we actually suggested we wanted to do something, had the support of the party, and then the European Union said no, my Jeremy would say, well, you know, you persuaded me to support the European Union, now they're stopping doing things which we all want to do. So who knows? I wait to see with interest, but, you know, I have a feeling that Jeremy would not be too displeased if we came out of the European Union, and he would be much freer to put forward a more socialist strategy if we did. But, you know, that I haven't spoken to him, and I don't know precisely what went on. My suspicion is that he was actually banjaxed, he was cornered, and he had to fight on so many fronts that he thought, well, we're not going to fight on this one because, you know, we're just going to be outnumbered, massively outnumbered, people wouldn't serve in the shadow cabinet and so on. So John McDonnell did tell me, he said the first fortnight after Jeremy was there, it was a complete nightmare. People refusing to serve, people bullying, people threatening, you know, and maybe it's just that was one battle I thought, well, we don't need to fight that one now, we'll leave that on one side, we'll say yes, who knows. But I haven't spoken to Jeremy, and I deliberately haven't spoken to him because I don't want to embarrass him, you know, because we're good friends. So, okay, well, you've got three more people here. If you three have three questions, well, all together, and then I'll try and answer them together quickly. So, is that right?
Three, yeah.
So, yes, one there.
Hi there. I'm not a socialist myself. I think I'm one of these horrible nationalists. But I am fiercely Eurosceptic. A lot of my friends in Cambridge, however, are socialists on the left, as most people in Cambridge are. So I know I'm putting you on the spot here a little bit, but if there was one key take-home message that I could send to them as white and voting for Brexit, what would that message be?
I think the thing that unites us all on left and right is democracy and the right to our parliament to decide the laws under which we're governed. You know, whatever else, we can choose how we're governed. We're not governed by some extra, you know, some supranational body. And I think that's the thing that unites us. So that's where Bill Cash and I stand together, on democracy. Now, I want to elect a parliament, elect a government, which is socialist and would do things they won't like. They want to elect a government which I won't like. But we would choose, and the people would choose. So democracy is what it's about. There's two there, sorry.
Okay. While I'm Eurosceptic, I'm more concerned about the survival of the Labour Party. And yeah. If the European referendum is close, and yeah. A big chunk, say 40% of Labour's own voters, not a huge chunk, but the electorate as it is, decides that the Labour Party doesn't speak with them any longer, just yeah. Like the Scottish nationalists who voted Labour don't feel that we speak with them anymore. Have you thought seriously about the consequences of us losing up to 4 million votes? How does the Labour Party avoid that fate? Because to listen to most pro-European MPs, these people are racist, knuckle draggers, they don't understand. Mm. These are our voters.
I'll say that's a major reason why I've stuck to this campaign, because I want if we came out of the European Union and Labour was entirely on the other side, or even if we stay in and Labour's entirely on one side, I think that would be terribly damaging for Labour votes. I think quite a few working class votes would slip to UKIP, possibly even the Tories, and that happened before the last issue. Some sociological research has shown that we would have won 8 more seats if we come out in favour of a referendum. 8 more seats. We should have stopped the Tories having an overall majority. The psychology of the government would have been very different then. They couldn't say we're a majority government. They would have governed and they would have had support of the DUP and whatever, but they would not have had an overall majority. And that would have been very different. And 8 seats made the difference. And it was because Douglas Alexander and, sadly, Ed Miliband refused point blank to contemplate, even though in the shadow cabinet. And Hazel Blears, who was hardly a left winger, came up to me and said, Kelvin, to go into this election opposing a referendum would be madness. Now, she said that to me before the last election. And I agreed with her. I said, well, Hazel, with that lot, you've got more influence than I have. You try and talk to them. Anyway, that was that. And one more question.
Yeah, I agree. I think what you're doing is extremely important for the long-term survival of the Labour Party as well. Mm. And I agree with everything that you've said on immigration as well, because I think it is an economic issue at the end of the day, control over our national labour markets. Mm. And if you look at the studies in the last 10 years or so, the people who have been hit the most by EU free movement with the expansion of the EU have been the bottom 20% of earners in this country, whereas the people at the top have actually seen an increase. So it has a differential effect, and it's a class issue, then I did say, but I agree you couldn't go the full way because you didn't support the referendum. My question though is, so EU freedom is one of the reasons that I think I want us to leave the EU, but my question is about the negotiations, and how would you perceive if we did narrowly vote to leave? Who would be leading those negotiations, and how could we ensure that us on the left, ensure that the settlement after the EU referendum is one that's most beneficial to British workers and prevents us from, say, staying in free movement even after we leave the EU?
Well, I think one thing, I mean, I agree with you absolutely, and I worry about it all the time. Because what would worry me is if we came out of the European Union but carried on doing exactly what we're doing now. Yeah. We stayed in the common fisheries policy, common agricultural policy, we didn't do anything, you know. So I believe that's important. But I do think that once, if we voted to come out, I think John McDonnell and Jeremy Corbyn together would say, right, we can now put forward a socialist agenda. That argument's out of the way. We can now put forward a proper socialist agenda. And I think we could win people over. Very strongly, but we'd have to go work hard, because if a lot of Labour politicians had supported membership, some might resign from Parliament or join other parties, or, you know, people at Chuka Amuno would probably want to go and work in the city or something. You know? So there are all sorts of whatever they would do, you know, and Stella Creasy and a few others, you know, I won't mention too many names, but the people who are absolutely fanatical. They would go. So I think it will be difficult. But I think once we've made a decision, then Jeremy and John and others around John Trickett and a few others in the leadership will be able to put forward a more socialist strategy. I have to say that one of the things I like doing is writing. I wrote this pamphlet, not realising it was going to take off. And we've got rid of 9,000 copies so far and just ordered another 50,000 copies. But it's amazing. But I also want to write a basic socialist agenda for the Labour Party for the future, in my future. You know. One thing, at a regional Labour Party conference a couple of years ago, I was a guest speaker at dinner at the end, on the Saturday night, and I got a copy of the 1945 manifesto, and I said, what about this? And I read aloud from it, and I said, that's what we want. And the place erupted in cheers, because it was so straightforward. We would set up a national health service. We would nationalise the railways. We would nationalise the mines. We would introduce blah, blah, blah. You know, it was just a socialist strategy. I said, that's what we want. I said, not all this waffle that maybe nobody understands or believes in. And it was just took off. And of course, some of the party apparatchiks were not terribly happy with my speech. But you know, it is a worry that if the Tories are there, they won't actually do anything. We'll technically have left the European Union, but not actually. One of the things about Norway, just last point here, Norway is allegedly outside the European Union, but because their political class are fanatically in favour of the EU, they sign up to most of the laws of the European Union. They don't, for the fisheries policy, of course, they keep out of, and their agriculture, which they subsidise themselves separately. But the rest of it, they keep saying, oh, well, we have to do it. They don't have to do anything. They choose to do it because they're the nomenclatura, as we call them, you know, the political class, the sort of layer of politicians and civil servants all on the same side. Just final point I would make, I go to a lot of European meetings in the European Union, and I was at one where we in Cyprus, and parliamentarians from right across the European Union, and I said to this chap from Latvia, I said, why don't people have their party labels, their party identity? He said, well, he said, in the European Union, your party makes no difference, he said. We're all on the same side. So, and he was being cynical. He was a lefty, and he didn't agree with my views. But you know, that is. And what's happened? PASOK, the former Greek Socialist Party, regarded as so dangerous, the colonels took over because they thought they were going to be too left-wing. Now they've just a branch of New Democracy, the Conservative Party. It's ridiculous. So, you know, it's going to be very interesting, but the battle won't be over even if we win the referendum. Got a lot to.
Okay, well, thank you everybody for coming. Our next speaker event is on the 1st of March. We've got Brendan O'Neill speaking on how the EU threatens our democracy. So please come along to that, but join me in thanking Mr. Hopkins. Thank you.